suddenly it's like something opens and I see everything as it happened then.
It is the nature of dance to exist for but a moment. Yet once there was something called the Ballets Russes, which for more than 50 years created some of the most extraordinary ballet the world had ever seen. Performed by some of the most legendary dancers ever to have taken the stage.
Everybody, come on the stage!
Ready for a surprise at 83.
I love him.
Look, it's useless trying to get lines and stuff. Would you stand with somebody and look gorgeous?
Here on this stage, in the Orpheum, is an assembly of the greatest dancers of the greatest companies of the 20th century. Please welcome them.
They were called the Ballets Russes. They were Russians who never danced in Russia, refugees in Europe who became international stars, and in the end, they were Americans who created audiences for dance where before there had been none. Theirs is the story of the birth of modern ballet. Ballet as we know it today. A story that begins in the late 1920s in Paris, with a group of little Russian girls who dreamt of a life in dance.
All of us, the Russian girls, was very poor at that time. Because my family and many other Russian family lost everything during the revolution. Yes, I'm third generation of dancers. My mother was a dancer and my grandmother was a soloist with Bolshoi Ballet. So when I was a little, they tell a two-year-old, I already danced around and dancing. I always wanted to dance, always.
I never wanted to dance because I never seen anyone dance. I never seen a ballet performance. I didn't know what ballet was. When we left Russia, like so many refugees, we lived in very difficult conditions. But at the age of 7, my mother took me by the scruff of the neck and took me to get some ballet lessons. And I didn't like it. It was much more fun in the factory yard, you know, climbing trees and throwing stones at each other. But one didn't argue with my mother.
My mother as well. There were so many Russian refugees in Paris, and every family who had children wanted their child to learn ballet. So we went to Preobrazhenska. She was one of three very good teaching studios directly from the Imperial Ballet School. I was about 8 at the time. She lifted my skirt up, looked at the knees, and she said, "Your knees will have to be stretched." And she looked at my back and she said, "Your back is very good, it's straight. Yes, you can come to classes."
I was taken to Madame Preobrazhenska and I was terrified. It's the first time I saw a real studio. Mirror, bars, lots of students. Tumanova doing her foyers like mad. Little by little, it caught my interest because, you know, it's not easy. It's difficult to do those things. So, you know, I was good climbing trees. I'm going to be good at that too.
Though the little Russian girls worked hard to perfect their technique, in late 1929, their future in dance held little promise. For the only grand ballet company in all of Europe had just collapsed. Sergei Diaghilev's Ballets Russes. Diaghilev was a Russian exile in Paris, who for 20 years had led a creative revolution that brought together the most brilliant artists of his day. Nijinsky, Balanchine, Stravinsky, Picasso, Matisse, and Ravel were but a few who collaborated with Diaghilev to create the distinctive Ballets Russes style. Groundbreaking productions that fuse the most avant-garde in music, movement, and design. So great was his influence that when Diaghilev died suddenly in 1929, there were those who believed that with him died ballet.
That was the period when nobody had any work. These wonderful people, you see, either in Paris or London.
Markova was dancing for 10 shillings a night at the Ballet Theatre on a Sunday night and make her own tutu. I mean, the dancers were starving. There was nothing for them to do.
But just 2 years later, in 1931, two men in Monte Carlo announced their intention to resurrect the Ballets Russes. One was a domineering Russian colonel named Vasily de Bazil, who fancied himself the next Diaghilev. The other was a cultured Frenchman named René Blum, who directed ballet at the Monte Carlo Opera House. De Bazil and Blum named their new company the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo. They engaged many of Diaghilev's dancers and choreographers, dusted off his sets and costumes, and sent their ballet master looking for new talent.
One day, Preobrazhenska said, "I'm going to prepare you girls for a very important man." The door opened and arrived this very good-looking tallish man. Preobrazhenska greeted him. He embraced her and kissed both of her hands and made a very low bow. And we didn't know who he was. He was Georges Balanchine, of course.
Georges Balanchine had first earned his fame as a choreographer for Diaghilev's Ballets Russes. Now, as ballet master for de Bazil and Blum, he was about to fill the company's ranks in an unexpected way.
That was Balanchine's idea to have very young dancers straight from the school. That was sort of an innovation of which Mr. Balanchine thought. Bless him.
Absolutely.
So that gave us our chance, you know. We're very lucky. We were at the right time in the right place, and he had the right idea.
It was January, and the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo assembled for the very first time. The company had only 4 months to prepare for its grand debut. As ballet master, Balanchine had a risky plan. Out of all the dancers, he chose three of the little Russian girls to be the company's stars. They would carry a responsibility far beyond their years. The two youngest were not yet 13, they all still traveled with their mothers. And yet, to a large degree, the success of the Ballet Russes de Monte Carlo rested upon the shoulders of these three unknown girls. Critics proclaimed, ballet exists again, and declared the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo the authentic heir to the Diaghilev tradition. From this moment on, the Russian girls were stars, and the press crowned them the baby ballerinas.
You know, the thing about the three of us that, you know, are known as the three baby ballerinas was that we were
each
so
were different.
Different.
Totally different.
Tanya was like a feather, quick feather, and a very definite personality of hers. Very special. I don't know. I didn't know I had a style. I was just a child, and then I was a grown up. Tumanova had her style, very dramatic. And this dramatic, mysterious, sad, in a way. And she was dark. Tanya was sort of very, very, very blonde. And I was neither here nor there, you know.
Irina's style was much more girlish. She was a great technician. She understood her roles with a lot of passion. The provocative, flirtatious way that she had with men was a lesson for anybody to look at. She was my perfect dancer that I admired the most in that period. No, no, not because you're sitting there, I really mean it.
That I don't have to show you. Eight front, eight back, four dégagé back, and four dégagé front.
Why do you still teach?
Well, because what will I do? Sell books? Self-wrote? So that's my life, you know? Front and fifths, side, fifths, front, fifths, side, fifths, side, plié.
From its earliest seasons, the Ballets Russes was a company pulled between competing artistic visions. Works by ballet master Georges Balanchine vied for center stage with those of four other great choreographers from the Diaghilev era: Michael Fokine, Václav Nijinsky, Bronislava Nijinska, and Leonid Massine. In 1932, three of these dance makers were still at work, and as guest choreographers proved to be powerful forces within the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo.
Michael Fokine was always just exactly like he wanted to do. So we have to really have to breathe, they have to look, and so each movement, how the body is, you know, all this, he was very demanding, sort of, but nicely demanding. I remember how this to run from wings to the center, it was probably 100 times. I already cried at to run just to do, listen here. Then he took my ear. No, don't turn right away, go there. He said, took my ear and go first, and then you go on it on the other side. Then, when the performance came in Monte Carlo Opera House, he came to me, Natasha, it was very good. I said, you know, you feel just so great when the boy, he say good, after all that work and tears. Yeah, I cry. I cry.
Nijinska became a guest choreographer, and she was the greatest slave driver. I don't want to use words that come to my mind.
Yes, she was screaming, also demanding.
She gave class every morning. She was wearing white gloves because she didn't like to touch the body of sweating girls. Her choreography is very technical, very precise, very complicated batteries, which is beating of the feet in different positions, which is really very neglected in ballet these days.
Massine was not only a choreographer, he was also a magnetic performer with an enormous international following. And in 1932, Massine was considered the greatest choreographer in the world.
I think Massine was one of the great stylists, and his work was not strictly classical ballets. They were ballets with classical technique in them.
Massine promised Diaghilev that he'll create 100 ballets. And meanwhile, he created something like 113. They were so full of innovations. And each ballet had a different approach, different theme, different characterization, different mood.
Massine wasn't that easy to describe, because I think he was always discovering something new. I mean, Rouge et Noir. It's amazing. the way I used to be thrown through the air. And I used to have to be boring in a back bend, all doubled up. It was the most modern work that had been done.
Messiaen's talents were dearly coveted by de Basile and Blum, who wanted him to be more than just a guest choreographer. So, as the first season drew to a close, the directors devised a secret scheme to push Georges Balanchine out and make Leonid Messiaen their new ballet master.
In 1932, Balanchine was the artistic director. And the next thing you know, Balanchine is left to do something, and he gets back to Monte Carlo, and there is Leonid Messiaen, artistic director of the Basel Company. I mean, when you think about it all, you know, the Russians weren't very nice to one another. They never were, and it's all, you know, how they all are.
And so began the Messiaen era of the Ballets Russes. It was the summer of 1933. The company debuted in London, and Messiaen stunned audiences with a revolution in dance. The symphonic ballet. No one before had dared to create ballets to the great symphonies of Tchaikovsky and Brahms.
Oh, uproar. The critics were, how dare he use a symphony? The music critics were dead against it. Oh yes, the music critics were awful, and they were very strong. You know, the music in London was...
Controversy aside, the public went wild. From this point on, symphonic music would be a permanent feature in ballet.
It was very enthusiastic. I remember going to rehearsals in the morning, and there used to be little chairs, folding chairs, with a queue right around the theater. We knew that it was a great success.
According to the young choreographer, Agnes DeMille, seeing a Messiaen ballet had become one of the great erotic pleasures of the London summer, with fans unrestrainedly screaming, jumping up and down, beating the railing, and slathering at the mouth. Leonid Messiaen's arrival ushered in another important change for the Ballets Russes. The return to the stage of Alexandra Danilova, Messiaen's longtime partner and Diaghilev-era prima ballerina. She was 27 years old and in her prime as a dancer. She and Georges Balanchine had once been lovers, but during the company's first season, Balanchine had refused to hire her.
Well, Balanchine said, I'm sorry, you're too old. Everybody was 12, 13, you see. It's a cruel business. Very cruel.
She had a flair. She was so popular. She'd come out on the stage and people would go wild before she'd do one step, people would start applauding her. And yet Danilova was not the greatest technician.
Maybe she could not turn to 32 for a take. That was not her cup of tea. But she was such an artist. When she came on stage, public used to love her. Because of her personality, she projects over foot light.
As ballet master, Leonid Messiaen differed from Georges Balanchine in many ways. While Balanchine had elevated the baby ballerinas and famously declared, ballet is woman, Messiaen, himself a dancer, created strong roles for the dashing young men of the Ballets Russes. And under his direction, their ranks began to grow.
ascend stairs, but I go on my heels and then I roll down the stairs. But that's only in my dreams. See, I'm still a dreamer at 83. Well, June 6th, 83. I'm George Zoric, and I dance for Massine with Colonel de Basile's company, Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo. And I ended up my swan song in 1962. And I'm still alive.
George Zoric. Oh, he was so good looking. He was the best looking man I ever saw in my life. Tall and thin, these planes on his face and his beautiful figure. Thin waist, wide shoulders, long legs. Well, he was just perfection.
He was very handsome, with the most wonderful body.
I think he was really born to be a dancer.
Oh, I think he has wonderful line, wonderful style. We danced a lot together. The first time we met, we was very young. I would not say what year it was, but I knew George's mother, and George knew my mother and my grandmother. And you did ask me once to marry you.
Oh, yes. I had her picture ahead of my bed, just like an icon.
And it was long
little
time ago.
Did I know what the devil was, was hanging over my head.
Okay. Look, you starting to bring me now.
No, I come from here. That's your bench. Oh, yes, I come from here. That's the bench.
Чтобы
я
вот
слишком
так, вот
стар,
там,
чтобы вперед ходить.
Ну, я нет, это на минутку выйдешь, чуть-чуть ты побрешься, и все это чудо будешь выглядеть. Волосы мы тебе такое...
Schmalzing me up. Giselle kiss, and here is lovelier girl than I thought. Look at her hands.
As 1933 drew to a close, Colonel de Basile and the company set sail for America, and into the arms of an ambitious and wily impresario named Sol Hurach. Hurach was the most powerful theatrical promoter in the States. He was also a Ukrainian emigre who held a special place in his heart for Russian ballet. And so, although nearly 20 years had passed since Diaghilev's Ballets Russes had toured the States, although an entire generation of Americans could not tell a tutu from a pirouette, Hurach placed an enormous bet on the new Ballets Russes. He bankrolled their first American tour.
when Ballets Russes came to Chicago in 1934, we'd go to watch the train come in when they arrived, and there was Irina Baranova with runs on her stockings, and there was snow on the ground, and she was picking up snow and throwing snowballs at one another. They were just a bunch of kids. I was part of a coterie. We'd go to every performance. We bought the 55-cent seats and took our field glasses, and there we were in business.
Oh, it was in Los Angeles. And we went to the Philharmonic Auditorium and sat up in what was called Peanut Heaven, which was all we could afford. And I thought it was the most glamorous thing I had ever seen in my life. I just couldn't believe it. When George Zorich came walking out, my heart just stopped. And then we would sort of sneak backstage, and they were talking in Russian and French to each other. To me, it was just so glamorous. And I thought, that's all I want to do, is to one day join that company.
I'd been studying 8 years at Marianne Wells School of Dance in Seattle, Washington. And Marianne said to me one day, you know, I have arranged for you to audition for the ballet. And I said, what ballet? She said, the Ballets Russes of Monte Carlo, Leni Mjassin. And I said, who? So on this particular day, I went to the theater where they were performing, and I walked over to him and said, how do you do, sir? And I shook hands with him. And he said, go dance. I said, yes, sir. I said, I have a war dance, but I don't have any music, and I do it in bare feet. So I went and I did this war dance, and at the end, I looked at Mjassin and he said, And 5 days later, I joined the company.
And so, Mark Platt became one of the first Americans to join the Ballets Russes.
My name was Marcel Emil Gaston Leplat. And then I heard the little rumors about they're going to change your name. I said, huh? She said, you're going to change your name. Everybody is Russianized. Everybody becomes, you know. I said, like, you bet they're not going to change my name. I said, no, I will not do it. So they changed my name to Mark Platov. So there we are, child dancer to old man actor. See, that's what happens to dancers, very good dancers who are maybe in their lifetime have been, you know, very well known. When they get older and they really don't want to leave it and they want to be a part of it. This is the best dancing role I ever had. It was a great part. Just dance my fool head off. So I was coming back kind of to what I used to do, but without dancing, of course. Because a pas de basque would kill me, and a plie hurts.
But By 1935, the now internationally acclaimed Ballet Russes de Monte Carlo had performed before more than 3 million people. The company's success fed de Basile's ego and his ruthlessness. A good director, he once declared, must possess the wisdom of a Solomon, the tact of a diplomat, and the cunning of a snake. In contrast, his partner, René Blum, held to a more gentlemanly standard. And frustrated by de Basile's autocratic ways, Blum resigned from the company. De Basile, now the sole director of the Ballets Russes, considered himself second to none. And this put him on a collision course with Leonid Massine.
At that time, Massine was having problems with Colonel de Basile. And I don't think it was not about money so much as about power. The colonel wanted more to say in what was happening with the ballet company.
It was going on constantly, I know. And naturally it fomented and boiled and came out.
By the spring of 1937, Massine, very quietly, began to make plans for his own dance company. He secured a promise of financial backing from Julius Fleischmann, the American heir to the liquor and yeast fortune, and secretly started searching for dancers. Alicia Markova had first met Leonid Massine when she was only 14 years old. At that time, Massine was a Diaghilev choreographer, and she was the youngest dancer ever to perform with Diaghilev's Ballets Russes.
Yes, they were the baby ballerinas, as they call them. Well, they were incorrect there, because who was the first ever baby ballerina? But I never said anything, you see.
When Diaghilev died, Alicia Markova returned to her native England, where she co-founded a small dance company called the Markova Dolan Ballet. And now, in the summer of 1937, Leonid Massine surprised her company with a visit.
I was a soloist with the Markova Dolan Ballet. And in the audience, I remember there was Leonid Massine and his wife.
Suddenly, Freddie Franklin came to me and he said, "Did you know that Mr. Massine has been coming and watching our performances? He seems to be interested. Who would it be?"
And then, after the performance, a young man came around and he handed me a note from Massine. And I read the note and it just said, "If you would like, please come to this address tomorrow morning," which was Sunday, "at 9 o'clock. So I went the following morning at 9 o'clock and I sat in front of Massine. He looked at me and he has those big brown eyes and he said, "I think it would be marvelous if you came to my new company as a premier dancer. Will you sign for 4 years? And I just signed and looked at him. And then there was the rumor that Markova had signed. But to me, the idea of Markova leaving the Markova Dolan Ballet Company was outrageous. So I had to go and make sure that she was. And that was it. And I said, "Alicia, have you?" And she said, "Have you?" And we said, "Well, yes." So that was it. She had signed and I had signed.
And with that, the word was out. Leonid Massine had left the colonel. And now there would be two Ballets Russes companies, with de Basile facing off against Massine and Massine's new company director, the Russian-born banker, Sergei Denim. A war erupted over everything connected to the Ballets Russes.
It was a very mixed up, chaotic time, you know, for everybody.
First came a legal battle over the company name, with Massine winning the right to use Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo. De Basile countered by renaming his group the original Ballets Russes. Next, the two men fought over the Ballets Russes dancers, forcing each to choose a side.
I went to Matisse and I said, Leni Filipovich, look, you go, I go. I said, you're my ballet master, I'm going with you.
Zoritz went as well.
Yeah.
Zoritz went, yes.
It's Matisse. Matisse knew what to bring for the audience.
For me personally, I had no problem. It was Colonel de Bazille's company. I had all the repertoire that was wonderful for me. There was nothing I wanted extra.
In the end, Colonel de Bazille held on to two of the three baby ballerinas, and Matisse chose to replace them with two dancers who had become stars through a totally new medium. The movies. One was Mia Slavenska. The other, Nini Teilhard.
At that time, don't forget, this is many, many, many years ago, it was very in to have something that we called recital. That means that a person stood alone on the stage and filled the whole program alone. And that's how I started. And for 3 years, I traveled all over the States with my own dances. And then Max Reinhardt, he discovered me, so to speak, because he saw one of these recitals. And he said, well, I don't know anything about dancing, but this person doesn't only dance, she acts. So I had always danced all by myself, or in Reinhardt's productions. Of course, I saw Baranova dance when she was 14, Tumanova, Rebushinska. I saw these companies wherever I had the chance, I saw them. So for me, it was a dream. So when suddenly came a telegram from Yassine, could I join the company in Monte Carlo? That is the best thing that ever happened to me.
Well, that is the first dance I ever danced. Look at those points. And I am, I think, 4 years old. Look at that instep. My mother made my first toshus, that's how I learned it. And she just cut the front of my baby shoes out and just made a slipper, like any kind of slipper. And I was on top. In many ways, I was actually an innovator. Even as a child, I would dream up things that were different. Nobody did it like me.
Oh, mais non, mais beaucoup plus vite.
Mademoiselle Beaupré l'a toujours dansé sur ce rythme.
Vite comme le diable, s'il vous plaît.
I didn't dance steps, I danced the music. I remember choreography by the music. And I might have danced the same role two or three different ways, depending on the music. Not one, two, three, four. How can you dance to that? Just like you can have, you know, this is the army, Mr. Jones.
Mia Slavenska won the gold medal in the 1936 Berlin Dance Olympics. 2 years later, at Matisse's invitation, she joined the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo.
I joined Monte Carlo as guest star because Matisse called me. And right now, at age, shall I tell? 84, expecting my next birthday. I tell you, it was a very difficult journey, But I wouldn't have missed it for the life of me in the world. I just wouldn't.
As 1938 began, each Ballets Russes company prepared for its debut. Leonid Massine gathered his dancers in Monte Carlo, where he faced a daunting problem. In the legal battle with Colonel de Bazile, he had lost the rights to nearly all his own choreography. Now, with a London season booked, Massine would have to create an enormous body of work in just a few short months.
We arrived in February, and by the end of April, he had done Gaîté Parisienne, Seventh Symphony, and Noblissima Visione, three enormous ballets with a brand new ballet company. We had all these people coming into the rehearsals. The painters would come in. It was more or less like it had been with Diaghilev.
And now the company had two great Diaghilev-era ballerinas, Alexandra Danilova and Alicia Markova.
This is where I first met Madame Danilova and Markova, and I must say, I have big admiration for them. I think I learned a lot from Madame Markova and Madame Danilova. They were great ballerinas. It was so wonderful when younger ballerinas come and they have a big stars in front of them.
I had two mothers. One was Danilova and the other one Markova. And they were always fighting over me. Because Shura said to me, you must make your hands like this. And Alicia came and said, not at all. Your hand to be like a... And in the end, I got completely crazy because I said to Miasin, I cannot have these two ladies standing in the wings. So every time I came in my prelude, you know, and saw one standing, and she said, and I turned around and I said to Leonid, and he said, no, okay, I'll talk to him. As characters, they were so different. Danilova was warm. She loved us all. She helped us all. If he had any trouble, not personally, but in the company, we could go to her and she would either speak to Miasin or try to, you know. Because you can imagine, there was always trouble. I mean, you can't have so many people with each one with his own temperament. Not to occasionally get, you know, this thing. Alicia was very much, don't touch me, don't come near me, I'm the star. But the actual star was Danilova, but I am the star. You understand? There was a difference.
She had this wonderful floating quality, which was Alicia Markova. No one else had it. She had this wonderful jump, and she wouldn't go terribly high. But there was this little lift, a breath, a little floating quality before she came down very softly. You never heard her land.
She never moved her shoulder, just like a spirit. And Dolin was always furious with her because she would not do plié or anything. She just stayed. And he has to lift her. And it's so beautiful, but it's hard for partner.
I consider her like a little medieval icon. She conveyed serenity and something very beautiful. But it's enough for a dancer to assume a pose, think upward, to make the waist slender so that you can press under the rib cage into a lift. But Alicia would assume very beautiful pose and half-smiled face, kind of exhilarated feeling and all that wonderful quality. But her waistline from here would go out like a pear. I was killing myself to lift that featherweight that weighed a ton.
Diaghilev-era. Now, of course, she wasn't easy. She wasn't easy at all. And she was an established star, and here am I, a young one, coming up. So my first meeting, she said, young man, I hear the Miasin like you very much. She said, tomorrow, I will see. And suddenly her name went on the board with mine. And I thought, oh my goodness, I'm going to be dancing with her.
Frederick Franklin and Alexandra Diaghilev-era were about to launch a 20-year partnership and originate leading roles in what would become the Ballet Russe de Monte Carlo's most beloved work, Gaieté Parisienne.
The next segment of this program is Gaieté Parisienne.
Come, dancers, where are we?
Coached by the inimitable Frederick Franklin.
Now, I must tell you that in the words of Alexandra Diaghilev-era, she said, it took 5 years for Freddie and I to get this thing right. She, Diaghilev-era, first of all, she said to me, how old you are? So I said, I'm 23, madam. Oh, she said, when you are 30, we will talk. So this was the beginning, and I thought, oh dear, well, there we are. And then we started to rehearse, and she said, now listen, you lift and I hook. You're going to do like this. You're going to one, two, three, and a lift. And down, down, bum, bum, go! Down, 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 turn! Now wait. If I were you, it would be like this. And then I would go, and this hand is still here. Right, okay. All right. Do you know the box step?
Yeah.
All right, the box step. No. One, two, three. Back, two, three. Four, don't, I'm not moving, I'm not turning, two, three. One, two, three, one, two, three. All right, now all we need is one. And back, one. All right. There you are. Wonderful. Good. Coordinate between the two bodies. And she finally relied upon me and she trusted me that I could start doing things with a nuance or with an arm or a different kind of lifting position. But at the beginning it was two bodies and it had to fuse. Otherwise it's not going to make anything of it. That's why the partnership lasted the 20 years that it did.
At the same time that Massine was preparing his new company in Monte Carlo, Colonel de Bazile had a serious problem of his own. How to replace Massine, the greatest choreographer in the world.
By contract, we had to have 5 completely new ballets, not seen in the season before. And so that was the beginning of Lichine's choreography.
The young dancer, David Lichine, stepped into the role of principal choreographer for Colonel de Bazile's original Ballet Russe. Lichine and Massine were now rivals. As such, they spent much of 1938 trying to woo dancers from each other's company.
Lichine tried to get a hold of me. And he said, I've got a new ballet. It'll be wonderful for you. There's a part in it. And it was the drummer boy in Graduation Ball. Oh, he said, you'd be perfect. And he said, I said, Mr. Nijinsky, I've signed a contract. Woo! You forget about contracts. It don't mean a thing.
But some contracts did matter. Sol Hurok was ready to back another lucrative American tour, and only one Ballet Russe company would get the contract. And so began the great London Ballet Wars of 1938.
At one point, there was de Basile's company and Massine's company performing in London at two different theaters.
It was really amusing, at least I thought, because all the regular people would start at Covent Garden, and then they all used to go only one block to Drury Lane. It was fabulous. You see Massine there, and Lichine there. Oh, you know, people used to get a little muddled, maybe. And the same with the artists, I think. But people were beginning to learn the artists' names. They would say, oh, is so-and-so dancing this evening? Which is what should happen.
Now, we're at Drury Lane in London, and they're at Covent Garden, the Basil Company. And the fans are going back and forth, looking at all the new ballets and the new dancers. Well, Hurok came and saw us, and he saw them. And this is the season that Hurok decided there was Massine and Danilova. There were the only two names. Markova, me, Slavenska, no one had ever heard of him in America. And he made a gamble, and we had the contract.
Massine and his ballet Bruce de Monte Carlo set off for America. Colonel de Basile, having lost the Hurok contract, took his original ballet Russe to the opposite side of the globe, Australia.
When we were told, you're going to Australia, we were very resentful because we thought it was a country of convicts and kangaroos. We didn't know anything about Australia, but the reception was so fantastic that we had the best dancing opportunities in our lives.
For 7 months, the original Ballet Russe filled the theaters. Never before had dancers of such artistry spent so much time in Australia. And it was this tour that set the stage for Melbourne and Sydney to become major ballet centers in their own right. In the summer of 1939, Colonel de Basile's company triumphantly returned to London for its annual season at Covent Garden. Massine's Ballet Russe de Monte Carlo was back in Europe as well, but a second round of ballet wars was not to be.
The season Covent Garden ended the end of August, very end, and 3rd of September the war was declared, and we were stuck in England.
We've been rehearsing in Paris, in the studio, second floor, when they announced the war. That was 1939. There was such a panic in Paris. And I look in the window, everybody was running. Now, many of us, Russians, who didn't have a decent passport without nationality, we have to wait boat. 3 weeks pass. After 3 weeks, quickly, the boat is here. So we quickly throw our things to suitcase, and here we was on the boat.
In the scramble to escape the war, dancers from both Ballets Russes companies found themselves on the same boat bound for America.
It took us 11 days zigzagging. They were afraid of German submarines.
The second day, the boat started to... And, you know, and...
I was in a cabin with Markova.
Markova, you could see through Markova. She'd been so ill. There was a nurse either side, and she's frail and fragile, being walked around. Oh, it was awful.
Mersin, he was a maniac with rehearsals. And all of us went more and more green. Besides, when we had to jump, we didn't know how to land, because either the boat went down and we jumped very high, or the plus suddenly the boat said whoop, and we came down, whoom, you know. So in the end, we said to him, Leonid, it doesn't work.
We arrived in the morning. We're herded into taxis and taken straight to the Metropolitan Opera House.
Right away on the stage, Mersin, look, quickly, quickly, take your places.
And Mr. Mersin said, Freddie, hello, your costume's in your dressing room. There's a dress rehearsal of Devil's Holiday, and of course you'll be performing it tonight.
So we rehearse, and same night we dance.
None of us had seen the ballet for 3 months. We hadn't had a class in weeks. I remember that I stood in the wings and I was looking a bit peculiar, and they gave me a shot of brandy. I would never have got through it. I could not have done it. And the brandy got me through.
Despite their harrowing escape from Europe, the Ballet Russes de Monte Carlo rose to the occasion and went on to break all prior box office records at the Metropolitan Opera House. The two Ballets Russes companies were now stranded in the United States. And Saul Hurach chose to represent them both. Each set off on separate whistle-stop tours to places where ballet had never before been seen. Small-town America was about to get a double dose of the Ballets Russes.
We were in the covered wagons of the ballet in this country. We were. We would go to towns, many towns. They'd just look, open-mouthed audiences, never seen anything like us. Strange people with strange names and strange-looking, wearing strange costumes, doing strange things. No way, no. Can you imagine if you go to anywhere, a small town, and suddenly you push on the stage something like Bacchanal? They've never heard of Dali. They don't know what's going on. They look there and think, what is this? They almost had us locked up because, you know, they'd never seen anything like this. Oh, the set was a huge swan, beautiful, all dripping blood and open in the middle, and it was sensational. And on the stage, there's an enormous fish, and inside there's a very beautiful lady, and she can manage the tail, which wobbles up and down. Nini Tialade was Venus. And a beautiful blonde wig, which suddenly sort of came down, right? Oh! So beautiful. Nini, that was Nini.
And I had to sit on that damn swan before, you know, and make love to that animal. I have to go through the womb of that animal. You know, the swan has a womb. And I have to go through there naked and all. Fine. In the wings stood Nia, Slavenska, and Yugoslav consul. And they were talking, and he left them, and so on and so forth, puts on his hat, goes and thinks he's backstage, and walks straight onto the stage, just at that moment that I come through the womb, you know, like Venus, you know. And see, it's an awful man coming. And he looks at me and I look at him. He takes off his hat and he says, "How do you do, madam?"
Well, talk about a success. You've gone down. They booed. They carried on. They whistled. They bravoed.
And do you know what Miassin said? "It's a pity I didn't think of that before."
It was marvelous.
I don't know how could we survive that tour. 9 months, so many one-night stands. We hardly have time to sleep.
And we never saw anything. We saw the theater and the train, and the theater and the train.
I don't think people will like to do what we did. We slept in the train. We worked real hard.
It was difficult, but we loved what we were doing. All right, we would get tired, but it never occurred to us to say, "Oh, a union, I'm going to call the union, you can't do that to us." No, it was fun, it was great, and sometimes you even got paid. What more do you want?
It was like this. There was a car for the soloists, ballerinas, and premier dancer. There was a car for the corps de ballet. There was a car for the musicians. And then there was a sleeping car, two sleeping cars, and a diner. And that whole thing moved across the country. We had 17 nationalities, and we had 8 mothers. Russian mothers.
And all the mothers were there, but they were not allowed to talk or to exchange thoughts or criticism.
But they exchanged looks.
They certainly did. They certainly did, yes.
If Tamara did some double fauteuils, you know, Mama Tamara was sort of very triumphant looking at other mamas.
She used to say, "We did today."
Yes.
32 doubles, we did.
Or if she wasn't pleased with something, she would say, "We don't do fauteuils tonight." Threatening.
In those days, it was a way of life to be a ballerina, to be in a ballet company. It wasn't just dancing, no. It was the whole aura, the whole privilege it was to be in a ballet company and to dance.
Yvonne Chouteau was one of 5 Native American girls from Oklahoma who joined the Ballets Russes companies during the war years, becoming the first Native American ballerinas who graced the stage.
When I was 12, I was given a scholarship at the School of American Ballet. So one day, some friends and I, we all said, "We're going to go audition for Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo." You know, 14 years, all of us, 14 years of age. Well, I thought, well, this will be a lark. So what do you think happened? I joined Ballets Russes at the age of 14. I was called the baby of the company. I hated it. But what can you do? Madame Danilova, who was so wonderful to me, but in rehearsal, called me over, and I was really her, you know, like a child to her daughter. She sent me on her lap. She says, "I'm going to call you Ivanchiks." And I was Ivanchiks for my whole career. Little Ivan.
Unlike the Russian baby ballerinas who traveled with their mothers, the young Yvonne Chouteau traveled alone.
To this day, I cannot hear Santa Fe or train whistle without thinking of the many, many years that I missed Mom and Dad terribly. Terribly. It was very hard. They would put me on the train, the Ballets Russes train, and I'd have to say goodbye again, which hurt, you know. And I, many years later, as I said, I realized that as happy as I was and fulfilled, there is a price to pay. There is a price to pay for everyone.
For 2 years, both Ballets Russes companies continued their wartime tours. But the relationship between Colonel de Bazile and Sol Hurak grew increasingly troubled. Finally, in 1941, Sol Hurak abruptly severed his ties with the original Ballets Russes, publicly declaring de Bazile to be one of the most difficult human beings he'd encountered in his entire theatrical career. Because Hurak held exclusive contracts at nearly every important theater in the country, de Bazile was now left without any American touring possibilities.
S. Hurak, he knew what he was doing. He had control of the United States, and consequently, he ruled the roost. And without Hurak, you couldn't go anywhere.
With the war still raging in Europe, de Bazile found himself with only one place left to go. For the original Ballets Russes, the Latin American chapter was about to begin.
See how I'm tilting my torso? One, look at the palm of your hands. Two, extend far away. Three, and four.
My name is Miguel Terkov, real Russian name.
And seven, and eight.
I was born in Montevideo. And when Ballets Russes came, it was so fantastic.
Give us some love.
I mean, it was like this, seeing all those beautiful people. All these foreign accents, everybody speaking in anything but Spanish.
In every city, they had a big national theater. Full, always. Applauses, flowers, newspapers, you know, it was just unbelievable. There were no company like the Bazile.
It was so fantastic. Those men jumping and turning. I never saw this before in my life. And I just decided I wanted to be a dancer. And so I talked to my father about it. He almost hit me. He told me that he didn't think I really would want to be a dancer if I knew how hard it was. So I said, Dad, I love you, but you don't know anything about ballet. How do you know that it's so hard? And he said, I don't know, huh? Wait. And so he went to this file cabinet, and he opened and took a bunch of programs, and he threw them at the table like this. Very dramatic. I mean, no wonder I'm the way I am. And and then took one of the programs and opened the page like this, and said, do you know who this is? It was him, in costumes and makeup. And so he took me to a teacher, Gala Chabelska. She had been in the Diaghilev company. That's the training I got. Then Ballets Russes came back and I auditioned and they took me. I was almost 14.
For 4 years, the original Ballets Russes toured constantly. But as World War II continued, Latin America slid towards economic ruin, and the company found itself stranded in increasingly war-deprived conditions.
There were times in which there was not much to eat. We ate bread with a little butter and a little sugar on top, and for breakfast and lunch. And yet we were lucky because de Bazile kept the company alive and he kept us dancing.
By the end of World War II, everything from the costumes to the scenery to the dancers themselves was in need of a long period of rest and repair. But that was not to happen, because by 1946, Saul Hurach and Colonel de Basile were talking again, and Hurach arranged for a grand return of the original Ballets Russes at the Metropolitan Opera House. And so de Basile and his hopeful dancers returned to America for one last disastrous tour. A tour in which the exhausted company paled before the memories of its pre-war self and suffered terribly at the hands of the critics. Hurach abandoned the company. America was once again closed to de Basile, and the ranks of his company thinned as the most talented dancers left for better opportunities.
A whole group left, and it was a whole new people who were coming.
I had the feeling that it was not the same company. I saw an audition, and they hired people that were not qualified to dance the roles.
A lot of young girls who didn't know Harley to dance, but they took them all because he had no money. And so everything went to pieces.
The bankrupt colonel desperately cobbled together engagements in post-war Europe, but his struggle to sustain his dwindling company was ultimately unsuccessful. On November 8, 1948, after a performance on the island of Mallorca, Colonel de Basile's original Ballets Russes took its final curtain call.
I wanted to stop dancing because Ballets Russes had been my life. Mr. de Basile was very upset with me, and he said, "You know, Miguel, once you put your right foot on the stage, you can never take it off. You have to put the left one too." And sure enough, he was right.
Miguel Terekov did indeed return to dancing. He joined the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo, which had ridden out the war years in a very different fashion. Wherever the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo went, they quickly became the toast of the town. And it wasn't long before Hollywood came calling.
Some of us went to Hollywood to not to audition, to how you the screen test.
One of the talent scouts and coaches from Warner Brothers attended one of the performances and got in touch with me.
Al Melnick with the Schur office said, "Look, they want you at Columbia."
"I think we should see this Nijinsky from Manchester."
"The name is Lawson, Tommy Lawson."
"Give your music to the pianist, Mr. Lawson."
"Oh, I have no music."
"Now I've heard everything."
I brought a style of my own, and this came out of the intrinsic art of the choreographers of the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo. I brought it with me to what I did in films.
Two movies in Hollywood, what they called The Gay Parisian, which sounds very odd now, and Spanish Fiesta.
It was at Warner Brothers. And at the rehearsals, there'd be Bessie Davis and there'd be Errol Flynn.
Cary Grant or, you know, Tyrone Power.
There would be Norma Shearer.
Charlie Chaplin on one time did send me in roses and presents and then wanted me also to stay, but between his wives, you know.
Oh, it was glamorous in those days.
Glamorous, yes, but not necessarily home.
Hollywood is a strange place.
It took 7 weeks to rehearse the number that normally in Ballets Russes could have been done in several days. But it was all right because I was paid 14 times the amount that I ever received with the ballet company.
I received a letter from David Selznick giving me a 7-year contract. I just did not know what to do, talk to my family, to my friends, but I didn't sign. I didn't like to be in Hollywood too much at that time. I have trouble with men. I always been in love.
Natalie Krasovska one time decided she was in love with the first violinist. And I was the best man at the wedding.
And Mr. Denham didn't give me one day for my honeymoon. I have to perform the same day.
It had to be in the Russian church. It had to be in the Russian way with the crowns above their heads and the candles, and she had her white veil.
Suddenly the bed catches fire.
And she still was standing there, totally oblivious that, you know, the flames were pouring around her head.
It was something else, and of course then the Russians say, disaster. Of course, 6 weeks later, she's divorced.
In the 1940s, few things were as glamorous as the Ballets Russes. And as the company's artistic director, Leonid Massine, had grown accustomed to indulging himself with the rewards of his position.
Massine's love of money caused an awful lot of trouble. 20,000 a year. A fortune! I mean, that was a king's ransom. And he never traveled with us on the road. He had his car and his chauffeur, and the chauffeur was the cook. And they had Virginia and Smokey, the dog. A beautiful Kerry blue, and they traveled all over. And the cook at night, he'd make the meals. And all the aromas would outside the stage door, they'd come wafting into the theaters. Oh, they're having this tomorrow, Russian cutlets, and that would go on. It was quite something.
But Massine was growing costly in other ways as well. For 2 years running, he had produced a string of box office failures, tarnishing his reputation and threatening that of the Ballets Russes.
He did Labyrinth, no good. He did Saratoga, no good. We did Vienna 1814, no good. His ballets were not successful. They weren't.
Director Sergei Denham and the company's backers grew alarmed. So in 1942, when Leonid Massine accepted an offer to be a guest choreographer for a new competitor, Ballet Theater, Denham seized the opportunity and canceled Massine's contract. The Massine era of the Ballets Russes had come to a close.
We all thought Massine was permanent. No. And it was terrible when we all learned he was leaving. And then we had nobody.
Now the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo found itself facing its first serious American rival. And a New York season with no artistic director to guide it. Sergei Denham, in charge of the company's creative decisions for the very first time, took a chance on an unknown American choreographer.
The time had been coming with American money that we needed American ballets. You know, something that's homegrown rather than Russian-grown. She was not a big name choreographer at all, but she was American.
The Russians in the company just hated her. They didn't understand her. She talked like that.
and asking them to do square dances and all this, what they thought were very clumsy things.
Danced? What kind of... Anyone who's not bedridden could be in rodeo. So, what kind of dancing was there?
Miss DeMille welcomed me with open arms. I started rehearsing, and she immediately gave me a little solo where I sort of breathed, you know, the end of the day. And it was a beautiful ballet, that rodeo.
Rodeo proved to be a runaway hit, with critics hailing it as the beginning of true American ballet. And Maria Tallchief's rodeo solo marked the beginning of a career in which she would become one of the greatest ballerinas of the 20th century.
Tallchief was my student. That's right. That's why she had that technique. Started with me, and she and her sister took my classes.
Mia Slavenska had a studio, and she arranged for Mr. Denham to come to watch the class. What I really think she wanted was like an audition for me. And just then, the company was going to Canada. So my phone rang. You are now coming into the company. Get on the train this evening to go to Canada. We arrived, and I think that day I learned three ballets and had to dance them that night because I was taking an emergency place.
You were in the corps then?
Of course, just in the corps. Yes. Oh, heavens, yes. And in fact, finally, I said to my mother, Mother, I don't know why I've studied so long classical ballet, because all I'm doing is dancing in boots, you know, the mazurka and the tchardas, also the can-can in Gaieté de Parisienne.
Hey, it's Freddy.
Freddy.
Freddy and his fiddle.
La, la, la.
It was the summer of 1944, and back then, ballet and Broadway generally didn't mix. Until the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo was given an opportunity no other ballet company had ever had, to star in and choreograph a major Broadway show.
I can't dance, you can't dance.
It was incredible. We closed a big Broadway show with a ballet. No big thank you very much, ha-ha, and... No, a ballet closed the show.
Freddy and his fiddle are at it.
The show was the Song of Norway. The stars were Frederick Franklin and Alexandra Danilova. And the choreographer was none other than the company's original ballet master, Georges Balanchine. In the 12 years since he'd left the Ballets Russes, Balanchine had bounced from ballet to Broadway to Hollywood and the circus, working with showgirls and screen stars, ballerinas and elephants. In each case, his initial success had turned to failure, and he was now a man with few prospects.
He was doing nothing. It was it. It was over for him at the time. Mr. Denham brought him into the company. He did the choreography for Song of Norway, and during that Song of Norway, he started Danse Concertante. Bourgeois Gentilhomme, the beginning of Ballet Imperial, the beginning of Sonnambula, and Mozartiana. He wanted to get back into the ballet company again and get to where he belonged. And we were the company that he came into. We benefited from him, and then he did too.
With Georges Balanchine in a creative fervor and the Song of Norway, a huge hit on Broadway, Denham asked Balanchine to be the company's resident choreographer.
I never heard about Balanchine in Yugoslavia, not a word. So I come to America and I am commanded that Balanchine wants me on stage pronto at 9 o'clock in the morning. And I said, yeah, who is Balanchine? He said, you don't know Balanchine? Blah, 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 blah. I said, no, I've never heard of him. I said, but I don't think he's a gentleman because I am a lady and I am not commanded to be pronto on anybody's stage, so you better give him that message. That was my first message to Balanchine. Not very smart, because with my kind of looks, he would have been very madly in love with me.
Balanchine's ideas were an abrupt departure for the Ballets Russes. His arrival brought sweeping changes that proved controversial with critics, audiences, and the dancers themselves.
The Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo was known for costumes, the scenery, and the music. And the Balanchine works became no costumes, no scenery, and lots of lovely music. I remember thinking to myself, this is the first time I'm going on the stage and I'm nothing. I'm just a body. I have nothing to do but go on and waltz. I don't belong anywhere. We'd never danced like this. We'd been something, a tree or a something. We'd been something.
I realized early on that I was not a Balanchine dancer. There was a certain form, even then, 43, very long legs, shorter torso. See, even then he was starting the image he wanted in his ballerinas. Small, sleek head. Not much emotion when you dance. Don't show emotion. Your body, the steps will show what I want to show.
Balanchine is interested in the movements of the female body. He liked to make people.
Balanchine must have seen me dance because immediately I was made understudy for Diaghilev-era. And I have written in my diary how nice he is to me and this and that and, you know. And it wasn't much after that. We were up in San Francisco or something. And he asked me to marry him. I said, George, I don't love you. And he said, but that doesn't make any difference. Love will come one day. So I said, well, I don't know. I'll have to think about it. George and I were married in 1946, August 16th, 1946. I was 19, I think.
He changed her whole technique. He told her she had no technique. After the performances, we'd all retire to a very fleazy little restaurant having spaghetti after the show, and Mr. B would be there with us, and he would have a big dish of spaghetti too, and he always brought one apple with him, and that's all Maria could have, because he was getting her ready to be a ballerina, and she wasn't to put any weight on. As an artist, that was his interest, and she took it all in.
Georges Balanchine remained with the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo for three successful seasons, but he was never named artistic director and had always dreamt of having a company of his own.
He wanted his way, his doing things.
He would only work if he got to be the king, or else he won't work.
Now, with Georges Balanchine's reputation on the rise, the time was right for his dream to become real. With the help of his longtime patron, Lincoln Kirstein, Balanchine made his move.
In 1947, he was leaving. He was forming a new ballet company. Tall Chief, she went with him, and it became the Ballet Society.
Ballet Society was renamed the New York City Ballet, and by the early 1950s was a formidable rival in New York. New York had become America's dance capital, and Sergei Denham realized that the Ballets Russes needed its own foothold in Manhattan. In 1954, Denham founded an official Ballets Russes school on West 57th Street. Young dancers from all over the country flocked to the school, where the company held annual auditions for places in the corps de ballet.
I was a tap dancer and a singer, and I left Jacksonville, Florida, and came to New York, and I went to the Ballets Russes school, and said, here I am.
I auditioned for the Ballets Russes, and there was no question when they said yes that I wanted to go with them. I mean, they did Swan Lake and Scheherazade, and Freddie Franklin was with that company.
I had auditioned either two or three times, and I wasn't ever chosen. When the third audition was about to take place, someone came to me and he said, Raven, I just want to tell you, don't take the audition because you really will not be able to get into the Ballets Russes. This is a touring company and they go in the South, so they could not afford to take someone with my racial background. So I thought, well, the least I can do is try. And of course, there's the great possibility that I never would be able to get into a classical ballet company, which I really wanted to do so very much. So the next audition I went to anyway, and lo and behold, Mr. Denham said, you're a lovely dancer, and I'm happy to tell you, you are in the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo.
The main thing about being in the corps was you had a really good family feeling about the people that were standing around you, whereas the ballerinas couldn't have that. I mean, they might have been at each other's throats. We weren't, because we were all there trying to make it as good as we could.
I was a little bit of a fanatic. I would get to the theater like 3 o'clock in the afternoon sometimes just to get my makeup, that every eyelash was in place. A little bit sick when I look back now. And, you know, it was very, very Barbara Streisand and Funny Girl.
Of course, we didn't do anything in Swan Lake but walk on and look and look and look for the swans and then stand and support them. We did no dancing, literally no dancing in Swan Lake. But when you were on the stage with that blue haze all around you, I can feel it now. And I felt I was in a ballet company. It was very, very moving. It was the most fulfilling time that I had in the Ballets Russes, was that moment, you know, just standing there with the music and the lights and the total rapture of the audience.
In my second season, I received my first solo, which was the waltz in Les Sylphides. And wherever we were, I don't care if it were someplace down in the deep south, if Les Sylphides was on the program and I was cast to do the waltz variation, I got on stage and danced it. We went that first fall and toured all the rest of the United States, came back to the South, nothing happened, and the next year, and nothing happened. And then suddenly, it started. I remember Montgomery. We came into town on the bus, and the Klan was having a rally. They were all out in the hoods and the gowns and everything. And these two men came down the aisle of the theater and yelled up on the stage, "Hey, where's the nigger?" We didn't say anything. So they came up on the stage. They went to one group and they said, "Where's the nigger?" And nobody batted an eye. And they came to the next group and nobody batted an eye. Then they came to the group I was in and nobody batted an eye. So they had to go away, and I swear their necks were red.
There was one embarrassing moment after the other.
It got to the point where, when they did the southern part of the tour, they sent Raven home.
The time was so difficult, but it wasn't a mistake that we took her. It wasn't. It was right.
I think she could have been an American ballerina. She was so good.
After 5 years of facing an increasingly hostile South, Raven Wilkinson left the Ballets Russes. she would never again be hired by a ballet company in America. By the early 1950s, it had been years since Sergei Denham had hired anyone to fill the hole left by Balanchine. Instead, Denham himself assumed both business and artistic authority.
Oh, Mr. Denham, he considered himself rather like Mr. Diaghilev. He really did. But he was a banker. That was his great calling. And it wasn't until later on that he became an artistic force. He was clever. Denham was a clever man. And he sort of eased himself into that position.
The company was now vulnerable to Denham's every whim. And then he fell passionately in love with a young dancer in the corps de ballet.
She was a muse, if you'd like to put it that way. And he was then determined, in his way, to make her a big, important ballerina at the expense of many others.
The biggest chance I ever had in my career was in Chicago, when Danilova had a bad knee and Coppelia was sold out. And Mr. Denham said, why don't you try Nina? I came to the theater and Madame Danilova said, Nina, you are dancing. Hi. And then before the performance, they announced that Madame Danilova is not going to dance and her place will be taken by Nina Novak. And the audience said, no, no. And naturally I started to cry. I am ready to dance and nobody wants me to dance. How am I going to do? But I went on stage with approach, that is not my fault. I want you to love me. Yes, I am going to do my best I can.
Denham was soon giving Nina Novak most of the best roles.
She wanted to be this pure classical ballerina, but she was not. The havoc she caused with the help of Mr. Denham.
One by one, disheartened and demoralized, the company's great ballerinas took their leave.
Danilova had stopped, Krasovska, Slavenska, all of the great stars were gone. I don't think Mr. Denham was seeing very clearly, to tell you the truth. Is it almost the same as Balanchine when he fell in love with Suzanne Farrell? It was like he went mad, but it was completely different because Suzanne Farrell, her talent was beyond compare, her musicality, and we all understood why Balanchine was doing it, but it wasn't fair to the company.
Not only were the great stars leaving, but the company's repertoire was growing stale. For a while, Denham hired a series of guest choreographers who contributed individual works, but by the late 1950s, he was commissioning very little new choreography.
We did the same ballets a lot, which is why I like Nutcracker Gaieté. Because of one-nighters, they didn't want to have to unpack the truck with all the scenery, and so they would pack those three ballets in the front and everything else was at the back. So if we stayed longer than one night, we were able to unload the truck more and do other ballets in the back.
Ballet Russes de Monte Carlo had not appeared in New York in 4 years, maybe 5 years. So I would think that if everybody remembers that you always did Swan Lake, Nutcracker, and Scheherazade, you would bring in, you know, the newer ballets or something else. We had no new ballets, we had no new costumes, and Mr. Denham just really didn't care.
He never refurbished anything in my day. For instance, if Scheherazade was being done, whenever I landed on the cushions, a great cloud of smoke would go up and the people would giggle. His one thought was certainly money.
Then one night, late in 1957, Denham instituted his most controversial cost-cutting measure during a rare guest appearance by Alexandra Danilova.
On that night, they'd done Giselle, it was getting late. And the stage manager came to me and said, I'm only telling you, Fred, but the curtain's coming down at the end of the can-can. I said, what? He said, don't tell anybody else. I said, what's the trouble? He said, overtime with the orchestra. Can't be. So then da-da-da-da-da-da-da, boom, boom, splits. Down came the curtain. She's on the floor. She said, no, Fred, what's going on? I lifted it up. No, she's me. Why? I said, that's it. We took the bows. She came off the stage. She said, where is Denham? Denham and Novak had quickly gone out of the theatre. They'd evaporated altogether. Then the press came back the next day. They said, what's going on here?
As the company's reputation faltered, Denham began to lose the confidence of his backers, and one by one they slipped away. And yet, financial woes aside, in towns from El Paso to Kalamazoo, the company remained a beloved annual attraction.
We were playing to full houses. We automatically thought that, well, that's it, we don't have to worry. But we did, because ballet companies, well, we all know, don't make money.
As the 1960s began, the company approached its 25th season with no significant new ballets, no great prima ballerinas, and a serious financial deficit. And yet, Denham and his dancers soldiered on.
He fought for that ballet company, he really did. Maybe it was Nina that had him going, but he did fight for it. And, you know, getting pennies from people to keep it going, but he did.
On April 14th, 1962, the Ballet Russe de Monte Carlo danced at the Brooklyn Academy of Music. And although no one realized it at the time, this was to be the company's last performance. Both Sergei Denham and Colonel de Basile tried relentlessly until their deaths to restart their respective companies. But their moment had passed. Vasily de Basile died in Paris in 1951. Sergei Denham died in New York in 1970. The Ballet Russe was gone for good. After the collapse of the last Ballets Russes company, the dancers scattered throughout the world. When they gathered for this reunion, most had not seen each other in nearly 40 years. But as much as the reunion was a celebration of the past, it was also, happily, a bridge to the future. What appeared to be fleeting could perhaps be passed on.
The legacy of the Ballets Russes, the young ones, the young pupils, I don't know if it's the way of living nowadays or their mentality is different. For them, it is more important to do 12, 14, 16 pirouettes. But there is more to it than that. It's very, very difficult to make them warm. Be warm, as I always say. Tell me something. But what can we do except try to make them understand? These things were taught to us, born with us, and never left us. And the young ones, where should they know it from? Now tell me, where? Where? Whom?
I never received money. You see, the time when I was working, we used to be paid very little. But that I thought, no, if I can work with this one and, you know, work with that designer, think how, you know, how rich I am.